Hi, this is Ravi Verma. In this video, I will cover all the remaining topics of this chapter. So we are going to discuss about the displacement reactions, the double displacement reactions, the oxidation reduction reactions, and at the end about corrosion and rancidity. In NCRT, in text questions and exercise questions will be discussed separately in the next video. Dear students, I suggest you that you should open your NCRT textbook while watching this video. And after every topic discussed by me, you need to pause the video and read the topic immediately in the textbook. While doing so, you underline the key points and definitions in your textbook and also make your own notes. Now let's start with the topic displacement reactions. Displacement reaction. In a displacement reaction, a less reactive metal is displaced from its salt by a more reactive metal. In order to understand this factor, we need to discuss activity number 1.9. So, look at figure number 1.8b. We'll take two test tubes marked A and B. And we will take 10 ml copper sulfate solution in each. We will also take 3 iron nails, clean them by the help of sandpaper, and we will tie a thread on 2 iron nails and immerse these 2 iron nails into the copper sulfate solution of test tube B. We will keep 1 iron nail aside for comparison. How we will immerse the 2 iron nails into the test tube is shown here in figure number 1.8. Here you see that we have tied a thread around 2 iron nails here, and the iron nails have been dipped into the copper sulfate solution. So we will keep these iron nails into the copper sulfate solution for 20 minutes. After that, we will take out after 20 minutes, we will take out the 2 iron nails and we will make observations. We will observe that the color of copper sulfate solution has fed up in test tube B. So here you see that the color of solution has fed up. But in test tube A, you will see that the solution has the same original blue color. We will also observe that the iron nail which has been taken out from the solution has got a brownish coating around it. But the iron nail that we had kept aside had no such covering. Why did this happen? Dear students, this happened because of the following reaction. Look at this reaction, reaction number 1.24. In this reaction, look at this reaction, reaction number 1.24. In this reaction, iron has displaced copper from copper sulfate. Here you see, iron reacts with copper sulfate and makes iron sulfate plus elemental copper. So in this reaction, we see that iron has displaced copper from copper sulfate, which is converted into iron sulfate. Here you see that iron has displaced copper and copper sulfate has converted into iron sulfate. But since copper sulfate had blue color, but it has converted into iron sulfate, this is why blue color has disappeared in test tube B. In this reaction, elemental copper is displaced from copper sulfate, which gets deposited, the copper gets deposited around the iron nail in the form of brown coating. Now the question is, why did iron displaced copper from copper sulfate? The answer is that iron is more reactive actually than copper. So now let us understand the definition of displacement reaction. This is a reaction in which a less reactive metal such as copper is displaced from its salt by a more reactive metal such as iron. So in a reaction in which a less reactive metal is displaced from its salt by a more reactive metal is called displacement reaction. Some other examples of displacement reactions have been written here. Here you see that zinc displaces copper from copper sulfate and makes zinc sulfate. Another example is that lead displaces copper from copper chloride and forms lead chloride. So in both the examples here we see that zinc and lead are more reactive than copper. So such reactions are called displacement reactions. Now we will discuss about double displacement reactions. In a double displacement reaction, there is an exchange of ions between two different reactants. In order to understand double displacement reactions, we will understand the activity number 1.1. We will take 3 ml sodium sulfate solution in one test tube and 3 ml barium chloride solution in another test tube. As long as they are separate, they are clear and transparent solutions. But when we will mix them into one solution, we will find that a white colored substance is formed that is insoluble and getting settled down in the test tube. This white colored substance is barium sulfate, which is getting settled down in the test tube. This barium sulfate is settling down and it is insoluble, so it is called precipitate. So any substance formed in a reaction which is insoluble in water is called precipitate. And such reactions in which precipitate is formed are called precipitation reaction. Now look at the chemical reaction that has taken place. In this chemical reaction, sodium sulfate has reacted with barium chloride to form barium sulfate and sodium chloride. What actually has happened? Here we see that chloride ions of barium chloride have been displaced by sulfate ions, and sulfate ions have been displaced by chloride ions. Sulfate ions of sodium sulfate have been displaced by chloride ions. So here we see that sulfate ions are displacing chloride ions and chloride ions are displacing sulfate ions. So in this way, this reaction or this type of reactions can be called double displacement reactions. Here we see that sodium sulfate and barium chloride are exchanging their ions, that are sulfate and chloride ions. So we can say that in a double displacement reaction, there is an exchange of ions between two different chemical reactants. Such chemical reactions are called double displacement reactions. Now, look at this blue box. This text box tells us about recalling of activity number 1.2 that we have discussed in earlier videos. In activity number 1.2, we have reacted lead nitrate, that is PbNO3 whole twice plus lead nitrate. We have reacted lead nitrate with potassium iodide, and in this reaction we found that a yellow colored precipitate of lead iodide was formed along with potassium nitrate, that is KNO3. So in this reaction also, dear students, you can see that nitrate ions are displaced by iodide ions and iodide ions are displaced by nitrate ions. So again, in this reaction you see that there is a double displacement reaction, or we can say that there is an exchange of ions between the two reactants. So this is another example of double displacement reactions. You have to check this reaction, is this balanced or not? If it is not balanced, you have to balance it and write the balanced equation in the comment box. Let me know which student and who is actually making efforts for learning. Now let us understand the next topic, that is oxidation and reduction. For understanding this topic, we have to discuss the activity number 1.10. In this activity, we will take a china dish and we will take some copper powder in it. Here is the copper powder. Okay, so when you will heat the copper powder, you will see that the brown colored copper powder has got a blackish color. This is because of a chemical reaction that has taken place. In this chemical reaction, copper has combined with oxygen to make copper oxide, that is black in color. So because on heating, copper has converted into copper oxide, which is black in color, that's why the powder has got a blackish color. Now, we can reverse this situation. We can return the same color, same brown color of the copper powder by doing one thing. This is if after heating copper powder, immediately we flow or pass hydrogen gas through the powder, we will see that copper has got the original brown color. This is because of this reaction in which copper oxide has turned into elemental copper as it has lost oxygen. So here you see in this first reaction, you see that when we heat copper, copper adds oxygen into it and converts into copper oxide. In this way, we can say that copper was oxidized. So, if a substance gains oxygen during a reaction, it is said to be oxidized, and such a reaction is called oxidation reaction. So, this is an oxidation reaction in which copper is gaining oxygen, or we can say oxygen is being added to copper. Okay, in the second reaction, when copper oxide is converting into copper, it is losing oxygen. It is losing oxygen. So then copper oxide will be said to be reduced. If a substance loses oxygen during a chemical reaction, it is said to be reduction. So what we can say that copper oxide is undergoing reduction and converting into elemental copper by losing oxygen. Here, one thing is very important to note that the oxygen lost by copper oxide is being obtained by hydrogen, and hydrogen is getting converted into water. In this way, there is an addition of oxygen to the hydrogen. So we can say that hydrogen is getting oxidized. So what happened in the second reaction? In the second reaction, this happened that copper oxide is losing oxygen and converted into elemental carbon. That means copper oxide is getting reduced. And hydrogen is obtaining oxygen. That means hydrogen is getting oxidized. So here you see that both reduction and oxidation reactions are taking place simultaneously. You see, copper oxide is reducing into copper and hydrogen is being oxidized into water. So when reduction and oxidation, both chemical reactions take place simultaneously, such chemical reactions are called oxidation reduction reactions, or simply redox reactions. There are a few examples of redox reactions given here. Here you see that zinc oxide reacts with carbon to make zinc plus carbon monoxide. What is happening? Zinc oxide is losing oxygen and converting into zinc. In this way, zinc oxide is getting reduced. and carbon is obtaining oxygen and converting into carbon monoxide. In this way, carbon is getting oxidized. So again, this is redox reaction. Another example of redox reactions is given here. Here you see manganese oxide reacts with HCl to make manganese chloride, water and chlorine. Here you see manganese oxide is losing oxygen, and this is how manganese oxide is undergoing reduction. But HCl is losing hydrogen and obtaining oxygen. In this way, HCl is undergoing oxidation. So this is another example of redox reaction. Now, from the above examples, we can come to the definition of oxidation and reduction. They are written here. If a substance gains oxygen or loses hydrogen during a reaction, it is oxidized. And if a substance loses oxygen or gains hydrogen during the reaction, it is reduced. So this is a very important definition of what is oxidation and what is reduction. Now recall the activity number 1.1, in which we have burnt magnesium. We have seen that magnesium combines with oxygen to make magnesium oxide. Here you see that magnesium is obtaining oxygen, or oxygen is being added to magnesium. So we can say that magnesium is being oxidized in this reaction. Now, the next topic is, what are the effects of oxidation reactions in everyday life? So first effect of oxidation reduction that we are going to discuss is corrosion of metals. Dear students, you must have seen that iron articles undergo corrosion, undergo rusting, in which a brownish layer of rust is formed on their surface. In the same way, silver metal articles develop a blackish color and copper articles develop a greenish layer on it. What is this actually? This process is corrosion. In this process, what happens? In a metal article, outer layer of the metal reacts with some substances present in the environment, such as moisture, oxygen, and acids. So the metal reacts with these substances present in the environment and make their own compounds. These compounds get deposited in the form of a layer around the metal articles, and this is why the metals lose their shine. This process is called corrosion. So let us understand one by one the corrosion of iron, the corrosion of copper, and corrosion of silver. In the corrosion of iron, what happens? That iron reacts with oxygen along with water and makes iron oxide dot Fe2O3 dot XH2O. This is called hydrated ferric oxide. So here you see that iron of any article reacts with oxygen present in the air and moisture, that is water present in the air, to make hydrated iron oxide, that is Fe2O3 dot XH2O. X means any number. X may be any number of water molecules. That is called hydrated iron oxide or ferric oxide. This is called rust. So here you see that rusting of iron is because of the reaction of iron with oxygen and moisture present in the air. In the same way, copper. In the same way, copper undergoes corrosion, in which reaction copper, that is Cu, reacts with carbon dioxide plus oxygen plus moisture, that is water, present in the air to make basic copper carbonate, that is CuCO3.CuOH whole twice. So you just note the reaction, the chemical equation: copper plus Cu plus CO2 plus H2 plus H2O CuCO3 dot CuOH whole twice. This compound is called basic copper carbonate. This is green in color, and this is why copper weasels develop a green layer, a greenish layer around them. This can be called corrosion of copper. In the same way, you have noticed that silver also undergoes corrosion and develops a blackish layer. Why does this happen? Because silver, of any article of silver, reacts with hydrogen sulfide H2S gas present in the atmosphere and makes silver sulfide plus hydrogen gas is evolved. So this silver sulfide is black in color, which gets deposited in the form of a layer, and this is why silver articles develop a black color. So dear students, corrosion causes damage to car bodies, bridges, iron railings, ships, and all objects made up of metals, especially those of iron. Corrosion of iron is a serious problem, and every year an enormous amount of money is spent to replace damaged iron. So dear students, as we have understood that corrosion causes a large amount of damage to the metal articles, you should be knowing the different methods by which corrosion can be prevented or reduced. You have to make a list, you have to make proper notes on the ways of reducing corrosion from your own sources. I will tell you a few names. For example, electroplating, surface coating, alloying, galvanization, and anodizing of aluminum. These are a few methods by which we prevent corrosion of metals. Now, the last topic of this chapter is rancidity. Let's discuss about what is rancidity. Dear students, what is rancidity? Look, when oils or fats or the foods containing oils and fats are left exposed to air for a longer time, you see that they become stale. Their color, their taste, and their smell changes. Why does this happen? Because of oxidation of fats. The fats present in the food react with oxygen to get oxidized. And this is why the food's smell, taste, and color changes. This process of oxidation of fat is called rancidity, and this is prevented by addition of certain antioxidants in the food materials. Or you see that chips and namkeen packets have been filled with nitrogen gas. So nitrogen gas prevents the exposure of these oil containing foods like chips and namkeens to the oxygen in order to prevent rancidity. In the same way, in our kitchens, we keep the food materials like biscuits, namkeens, in airtight containers. If we contain them in airtight containers, then rancidity is reduced. So dear students, this is all about the chapter number 1. You have been given a number of in-text questions and exercise questions in the NCERT chapter. This is for you. You should prepare these questions. You should practice these questions. However, I will also make a separate video describing the solutions of these questions from NCERT. Thank you for watching this video. Keep studying, keep making your notes, keep revising the topics, and do extensive work out whatever you learn. And the most important thing regarding your preparation is that